talk, shop, pop, movies.
Ahoy there, this is Derek, the Convicted Cinephile, and if you're a convicted cinephile yourself, please like, share, and subscribe to the channel down below. On my channel, I like to talk, shop, and pop open, that is, movies and physical media. And I'm going to do another tier list ranking today, kind of like the one I did the other day for the best picture winners of the 21st century so far. This time I'm doing a best actor winners of the 21st century. So going from the year 2000 with Russell Crowe in Gladiator, all the way up through last year with Brendan Fraser for The Whale. So everything in between those I'm going to be ranking. I've seen all of these movies and performances, so they are gaugeable by me. I don't have to like give something the benefit of the doubt or anything like that. So I figured this is the good one to do next. I will hopefully be able to do these for multiple categories. That would be nice. Supporting actor, maybe actress, supporting actress as well. But best actor just seems to be the easiest one because, as anyone who pays attention to the awards circuit knows, the male-led films typically have a better chance of getting into Best Picture. And if something gets into Best Picture, we have a better chance of having seen it. That includes myself, because I try to at least see every Best Picture nominee, and most of these fall under that category. So that's why I have seen all of these a little bit easier than I've seen all the Best Actress winners, for example, in the past century. I've seen most of them, but there's a few in there that I would need to catch up on. But it would give me something to do, so maybe it'll motivate me to do this. Who's your favorite Best Actor winner of the 21st century so far? I don't know. We'll find out who mine is, I guess, by the end of this thing. I am ranking it not just purely by like, oh, this is my favorite movie. I'm going to go with the different guidelines here of career best on top. That means I believe not only is this the best winner of the year, this is arguably, at least, their finest performance ever. Therefore, it's like the perfect movie for them to win. Best of the year means it may not be this specific actor's finest role, but it was the best option that year out of all the nominees. Not the right choice means I think there would have been a better winner, but it's a fine winner nonetheless and a good performance. And the bottom tier is just flat out bad winner, meaning it's one that shouldn't have even been nominated, in my opinion, or was at the very least the worst performance nominated. So those are the tiers, and we'll be going in order. They're not in order on the bottom, so I'll have to search and find the actor as I go, but it works out. And there's a couple people on here who won twice this decade. Actually, is there? Yeah, there's two, I think. So we'll see which one is their career best and which one is not, if either of them are, let's say. So 2000, we had Russell Crowe in Gladiator. The other nominees that year were Javier Bardem for Before Night Falls, which I still need to see. I love Javier. Tom Hanks for Castaway, Ed Harris for Pollock, and Jeffrey Rush for Quills. This seemed like a fairly, well, I won't say easy win. Tom Hanks in Castaway, I think if he hadn't already won 2 years in a row in the 90s, he probably could have won for Castaway. But Russell Crowe was the up-and-coming winner of the year. He was nominated the year before for The Insider, and then the year after that for A Beautiful Mind. So Gladiator was the movie that he did win for. Let's find Gladiator down here at the bottom. There he is. He's got like a shirt on, or like his like armor on. So it was harder to tell. Great performance, obviously. Is it his best performance ever? I think most people would probably say it is. I actually like him at least as much, if not more, in Beautiful Mind the next year. I thought that was a more interesting performance. I really like him in Cinderella Man, which I actually just rewatched for some, just out of nowhere. I just felt like watching Cinderella Man the other day. And then he's great in The Insider. He's a great actor when he's in something that's good. Let's put it that way. But it's at least the best of the year, I would say. Actually, I don't even know if it's the best of the year, because I like Tom Hanks and Castaway maybe a little bit more personally. But he's at least a best of the year quality. But given the physicality of the role, you know what? I will give him career best for Russell Crowe. I will give him that. I prefer the movie to Beautiful Mind, but I probably prefer that performance. But a lot went into this role. And for it being like an action spectacle movie, People don't win best actor awards for those very often. Next year we have Russell Crowe yet again for Beautiful Mind, like I said, Sean Penn for I Am Sam, Will Smith for Ali, Denzel Washington, who won for Training Day, and Tom Wilkinson for In the Bedroom. Four of these five guys are in this tier list today, so that's interesting. The only one who's not, sadly, is the late, great Tom Wilkinson, who was amazing in the Bedroom. And if I were to pick, I would have voted for Tom Wilkinson in the Bedroom this year. My second favorite above that would have been Russell Crowe in A Beautiful Mind. I'm not a big fan of Denzel Washington in Training Day. Like, he's good. But I don't think it was the right winner. I think 90% of the reason he won was both as a makeup award for Malcolm X years earlier, and it was one of the first, at least, bigger Oscars so white things that happened. You know, they like to do that every 3 years. But that was like the biggest one. And then he and Halle Berry ended up winning that year to shut everybody up. very good performance. It's a good movie. I'm not a massive Training Day fan. Most people seem to like it more than I do. It's not the best of the year. It's not his best performance. That would be Malcolm X, in my opinion. I don't think it's the right choice, honestly. It's not a bad winner, but it's not the right choice. I would have voted for two other people over him that year. Personally, at least two other people, let's put it that way. R.I.P. Tom Wilkinson. Best performance of that category. Everyone's already clicking off the video because I'm crapping on Denzel winning. I don't care. That's just what I think, okay? Come on. 2002, the winner, surprise winner, was Adrian Brody for The Pianist. Then we had Nicolas Cage for Adaptation, Michael Caine for The Quiet American, Daniel Day-Lewis for Gangs in New York, and Jack Nicholson in About Schmidt. That's actually a really good category. Quiet American with Michael Caine is probably the least memorable of the nominees here. I love Nicolas Cage in Adaptation, and everyone thought either Daniel Day-Lewis or Jack Nicholson would win. And then Adrian Brody kind of came out of nowhere and won it. But the reason he won is because people watched The Pianist, and it's an amazing performance. You could argue it's the best of the year. I love Daniel Day-Lewis in Gangs of New York. But not only is it at least on par with Best of the Year, it is far and away the best thing he's ever done. So I will put career best quality performance for Adrian Brody. And that's when you should win. You should win for your finest role yet. It shouldn't just be like, oh, you're overdue. Like, that's fine sometimes. Sometimes it works out. But the right person for the wrong role is often a thing that happens for the Oscars, a la, my opinion, for Denzel Washington for Training Day. But sometimes they get it right. Adrian Brody has never and probably will never be better than he was in The Pianist. 2003, we have Johnny Depp with his first nomination ever for Pirates of the Caribbean, Curse of the Black Pearl, of all things. Ben Kingsley for House of Sand and Fog. I think I haven't seen that one yet. Jude Law for Cold Mountain. I like Cold Mountain. Bill Murray for Lost in Translation. And Sean Penn for Mystic River, who won. A lot of people thought Bill Murray was going to win. I was not surprised that he lost, although it would have been kind of cool if Bill Murray won an Oscar, especially since Sean Penn would win yet again like 5 years later. I would argue that this is my favorite performance of the category. And I do like the movie a lot more than I like Lost in Translation for Bill Murray. Is it his career best? As far as movies he was nominated for, I would argue that it may be his best nominated role, at least. I love him in Milk, though. And he plays a lot more. You know, I'm going to put him in Best of the Year. I love Mystic River. But I think he plays more against type in Milk. So you can probably guess where that one's going to end up going. but Mystic River, I love that movie. It's so good. 2004, we have Don Cheadle for Hotel Rwanda, Johnny Depp again for Finding Neverland, Leo DiCaprio for The Aviator, Clint Eastwood for Million Dollar Baby, and Jamie Foxx for Ray. No Eternal Sunshine for Jim Carrey, no Sideways for Paul Giamatti somehow, however the hell that happened. Such a good year, though. I love the 2004 nominees, and they still, like, if those two guys can't get in, you know it was a good year. But Jamie Foxx was going to win for Ray. He won for Ray. That is a career best performance, bar none. I'm not even going to argue. I love DiCaprio in The Aviator. He's been better in other things, arguably. But yeah, Jamie Foxx, right role at the right time for the right actor for that one. 2005, we have Philip Seymour Hoffman for Capote, his only leading actor nomination, sadly. Terrence Howard for Hustle and Flow, Heath Ledger for Brokeback Mountain, Joaquin Phoenix for Walk the Line, and David Strathairn for Good Night and Good Luck. This is a good category, too. They're all pretty good. Best Actor is always pretty solid. But, of course, Philip Seymour Hoffman won that year. Like I said, it's sad that it's his only leading actor nomination. I prefer him in other movies, but as far as his lead roles go, it doesn't get better than him in this movie. And he changed a lot physically. He changed his voice around without sounding too hammy, because Capote is just such a weird way of speaking. And he nails it without making it funny or like a caricature. So PSH, one of the greatest actors of all time. R.I.P. I love him. 2006, we have Leonardo DiCaprio for Blood Diamond, Ryan Gosling for Half Nelson, Peter O'Toole for Venus, Will Smith for The Pursuit of Happiness, and Forrest Whitaker for The Last King of Scotland. That's kind of one that gets forgotten about, it seems like, for movies in general and best acting wins. He pulled off a very rare feat, especially nowadays, of being the only nomination for his film and winning, which does not happen in best lead actor ever, hardly. Like, I'll have to look back and see how often that's ever happened, especially in the more modern days. Like, back in, like, the 30s, it may have happened, because they only had, like, four categories back then. But these days, like, he's the only person in this list who was the only nomination for his film who won. He is absolutely hilarious and terrifying in this movie. I will put him down for a career best easily, and it's kind of a shame it's the only nominations he's ever had, but this is the perfect example of perfect time to celebrate an amazing character actor who finally got his, like, perfect leading role and just knocks it out of the park. I really am. I'm overdue for a watch on that one. It's a good movie. It's got James McAvoy and Gillian Anderson in it, too, if I remember right. Apparently, a lot of these are going to be career bests, but that's kind of what it's supposed to be, right? This should be, like, your best role ever. All right, 2007, we have George Clooney and Michael Clayton, Daniel Day-Lewis, the winner for There Will Be Blood, Johnny Depp again for Sweeney Todd, Tommy Lee Jones for The Valley of Elah for some reason. That movie is so forgettable. It's like an episode of CSI or something. Viggo Mortensen, awesome nomination for Eastern Promises. That was his first nomination as well. But Daniel Day, three-time winner Daniel Day-Lewis, DDL, arguably at least the greatest living actor. Like I said, there's a couple people on here with multiple wins in this 20-plus years. He's one of them. He won again for Lincoln in 2012, so we'll get to that when we get to that. Out of everything I've seen with him in it, which is a good number of movies, and he's great in all of them that I have seen, this is far and away my favorite role of his. My Left Foot is up there. Lincoln is probably just beneath that, personally. Gigs in New York, I'd probably put above Lincoln. Daniel Day-Lewis and There Will Be Blood. Holy shit, that movie's great. I wish it didn't come out the same year as No Country for Old Men, because then Paul Thomas Anderson would probably have three Oscars now. But it just didn't work out that way. 2008, we had a nice little surprise sort of nomination for Richard Jenkins for The Visitor, which is a nice little movie if you haven't seen it. Another great nomination, which is awesome. Frank Langella finally got his first nomination for Frost Nixon, which is a very solid movie. I like that movie a lot, actually. Sean Penn won again for Milk. Brad Pitt won for The Curious Case of Benjamin Button, nominated for The Curious Case of Benjamin Button, and Mickey Rourke nominated for The Wrestler. Sean Penn won for Milk. I was going to put it in career best. But I honestly don't think it was even the best choice of the year. I wanted Mickey Rourke to win that year. I wanted them to tie. That would have been perfect. But I already put Sean Penn here in best of the year. I prefer this performance over his Mystic River performance. I like the movies about equally. Probably like Mystic River a little more, if I had to pick. But I like him in Milk more than I like him in Mystic River. So I will put it in career best. But I would also have put Mickey Rourke in career best, because I think he deserved it just as much, if not more. Damn it, Sean Penn, why are you so good in these two things? make it weird. 2009, we have Jeff Bridges, who finally won for Crazy Heart, George Clooney for Up in the Air, Colin Firth with his first nomination for A Single Man, Morgan Freeman for Invictus. Remember that movie? No, you don't. Jeremy Renner for The Hurt Locker, which was his first nomination. Very cool. Jeff Bridges, like I said, won. He was the last person to win without his movie being nominated for Best Picture until Brendan Fraser last year. I love Jeff Bridges. It's not my favorite performance of his ever. I will say that. But it was the best nomination that year, and I'm glad he finally won. So I will put him in Best of the Year, but it's not my favorite performance of his. I like him more in True Grit, but that's a remake, so it's kind of weird. I mean, I love him in Big Lebowski. I like him in a lot of stuff, but he's amazing in Crazy Heart. 2010, we have Javier Bardem for Beautiful, Jeff Bridges for True Grit, Jesse Eisenberg for The Social Network, Colin Firth for The King's Speech, and James Franco for 127 Hours. Colin Firth won that year, and then it won Best Picture and Director, like it shouldn't have. But Colin Firth winning is a great win. Like, if it would have just won Best Actor and Best Screenplay, that's all you need. That's all that movie needed to win. So it's at least, is it the best of the year? I'd say I love Jesse Eisenberg at Social Network, but I'm kind of biased towards that movie because I love it so much. But Jesse Eisenberg is kind of similar in all of his roles, but he just plays it a little differently in that. That's like Jesse Eisenberg to the max. I'm just trying to gauge it based on what's above it here. Colin Firth, it's probably my favorite Colin Firth performance. I haven't seen him in like a ton of stuff besides like schmoozy romantic comedies that I'm not a huge fan of, to be honest. And he's always good. And I haven't seen his other nominated role, The Single Man. So I personally would probably put it in Best of the Year because I'm glad he won. And I'd say it's at least equal to the best performances in that category. But it's not like an all-timer win. 2011, we have Damien Bashir for A Better Life. That was a cool little movie getting nominated there. George Clooney for The Descendants. Jean Jourdain for The Artist. Gary Oldman for Tinker, Tailor, Soldier, Spy, finally getting his first nomination after a million years. And Brad Pitt in Moneyball, which is my favorite movie far and away out of these five. Jean Jourdain won. I'm probably saying his name wrong. There was, I don't know, I think that's a weak year. 2011 is pretty weak for the most part, at least for most nominations. My favorite out of those, like I said, is Brad Pitt in Moneyball. I would have been cool if he won for that, but like a movie like that never wins lead actor. What he had to do in this movie as a silent film, a modern day silent film, essentially, he does do a really good job. And being a French actor, he translates to any language because it's a silent film. So he does that wonderfully. I don't know him well enough to say it's his best role ever. It just happens to be the one he was in that won every Oscar. So I'll put it in Best of the Year. Because honestly, none of those other nominees are like, that should have won to me. Eventually, we'll get a flat-out bad winner, don't worry. And a couple more not the right choices, I'm sure. 2012, we have Bradley Cooper for Silver Linings Playbook, Danny Day-Lewis winning again for Lincoln, Hugh Jackman for Les Miserables, Joaquin Phoenix for The Master, and Denzel Washington for Flight. Now that I am rereading this list, I'm not going to put who I thought. I mean, Daniel Day-Lewis won. We know that. I was going to put him in Best of the Year, and then I reread the list of nominees that year, and Joaquin Phoenix in The Master was outstanding. That is my favorite Joaquin Phoenix performance, probably. It's at least as good as he is in The Joker, if not better. So I'm actually going to put Daniel Day-Lewis, as much as I love the man, in Not the Right Choice. I think Joaquin Phoenix was the best performance in that category, personally. I would have loved if Hugh Jackman won, just because I love Hugh Jackman. He's great. Bradley Cooper was just happy to be there and be taken seriously at that time. And Denzel Washington for Flight was never going to happen, but he's Denzel, so he gets in. 2013, we had Christian Bale for American Hustle, Bruce Dern in Nebraska, who is amazing. Leonardo DiCaprio for The Wolf of Wall Street. Chiwetel Ejiofor, if I'm saying that correctly, I'm terrible at saying his name, for 12 Years a Slave. And Matthew McConaughey for the Dallas Buyers Club, who won. This is kind of a tough one, because I would have preferred Leonardo DiCaprio to win for this movie. I think he was my favorite of the year, but I'm not going to deny the fact that this was, at least at the time, and probably still is, Matthew McConaughey's finest performance. It's the only one he was nominated for so far, and he won. It was the McConaissance, as we all remember. So I will give him a career best just for that, because it was like the peak of his career, coming back from being in nothing but crappy rom-coms for a decade. Had DiCaprio won that year, I probably would have also put that in career best personally. So you can have multiple career bests in one category. It happens. I'm trying to keep some logic in this, and don't worry, I'm going to fail. 2014, we had Steve Carell in The Foxcatcher. Love that nomination. Bradley Cooper in American Sniper, stealing Jake Gyllenhaal's spot at the last second. Benedict Cumberbatch for an Imitation Game. Michael Keaton for Birdman, and Eddie Redmayne for The Theory of Everything. This one is also tricky because I would have preferred Michael Keaton winning for Birdman. This is another case where I was like, I wish they could tie because I loved Eddie Redmayne. But there is no denying that this is probably Eddie Redmayne's finest role ever. It wasn't the best of the year. At least most people would say so. I say they're on par with each other. They're just such different performances. But as far as like a biopic performance goes, this is about as good as it gets. So I will put Redmayne in career best performance. I didn't expect to do that. But Michael Keaton, I probably would have done the same for. Cumberbatch would have been a good winner. Cooper would have been fine. Carell would have been interesting. But either way, it would have been career best, I'd say, for Keaton or Redmayne there. Like I said, it could happen more than once. That's what sucks when there's like a couple in there that are fighting it out. I mean, it's more fun during the awards race, but in hindsight, it's like, oh, I wish that could have happened because such and such. 2015, this was a fairly weak year overall. Everything here is good. So we have Bryan Cranston for Trumbo, which was never going to work or never going to win, but Bryan Cranston's great. Everyone loves him. Matt Damon for The Martian, which is a great Matt Damon performance. He's kind of Matt Damon in most of the things he's in, but damn, is he good at playing Matt Damon. And he's always convincing. I always believe that he's Matt Damon. Leonardo DiCaprio, who won for The Revenant, which I love the movie, but it's not my favorite DiCaprio performance. Michael Fassbender for Steve Jobs, who is probably the next best choice after DiCaprio in this category, in my opinion. And Eddie Redmayne again for The Danish Girl. So we have DiCaprio. Just the fact that it's yay, DiCaprio finally won an Oscar, I would put it in career best, but he's been nominated enough times that I could say he should have won for something else. And this was just like the we have no other choice but to give it to him this time win. Not that he didn't deserve it, but he is easily the best choice of the year. I'll put him in there for now. Michael Fassbender would have been a very interesting choice as well. I think that would have been kind of cool, but then, Leo wouldn't have an Oscar. Had Leo already had an Oscar, I think Michael Fassbender would have been a cool win. 2016, we have Casey Affleck in Manchester by the Sea, who was the winner. Andrew Garfield in Hacksaw Ridge. Ryan Gosling for La La Land. Viggo Mortensen for Captain Fantastic. That was like a only nomination thing there. And Denzel Washington for Fences. Casey Affleck won essentially everything except for the Screen Actors Guild Award, which went to Denzel because he had never won a Screen Actors Guild Award for some reason at that point. So it was the perfect time to give him one. But Casey Affleck did end up winning. I was happy about that. It's a very understated performance, which those don't often win. They're usually a little more showier. They're usually a biopic performance like Eddie Redmayne or Sean Penn in Milk, or even Forest Whitaker for that matter. Or Capote, like you can tell the top row is all but two of those are biopic performances, but when they're good, they're good. But this is probably my favorite subtle acting win in recent memory. And stuff like this doesn't usually win because it goes under the radar as being good because it's so subtle, and that's what makes it so great. So I'm going to give him career best quality on that one. Casey Affleck breaks your heart in that movie, at least for me. Denzel was probably in second place. Like I said, he won the SAG award. But to me, he was just playing Denzel in that movie. Even more so than he was in Training Day. He's great. He's kind of like Matt Damon. He's just Matt Damon and everything. To me, Denzel in most movies, he's just playing Denzel. He's damn good at it. But I always just see Denzel Washington. I don't see the character he's playing. Maybe that's my problem. I don't know. 2017, we had Timothée Chalamet for Call Me by Your Name, his breakout role. Daniel Day-Lewis again for Phantom Thread. Daniel Kaluuya for Get Out. Gary Oldman for Darkest Hour, who finally wins an Oscar for that, and Denzel Washington for Roman J. Israel Esquire, and he was the only nomination for that movie that nobody saw. And there he's actually playing like a weird character, so it's a more interesting role for him. So where were we? Darkest Hour, Mr. Gary Oldman. He is such an iconic actor that it's almost impossible to say something is his best, but I don't think I would want to put it in career best because he's so good. There's another one who's arguably the best living actor right now, but I will give him best of the year. Timothée might have been career best quality because I don't think he's topped that role, but he's also so young that he has a lot of time to do so. But Gary Oldman, It was a overdue win slash good lead actor caked in makeup biopic win, but that's all it really was. It wasn't something out of the ordinary to me, but I love Gary Oldman, so I'm not going to give him a not the right choice or a bad winner. I don't want Gary Oldman to come beat me up because he could. 2018, we have Christian Bale for Vice, Bradley Cooper for Star is Born, Willem Dafoe for At Eternity's Gate, Rami Malek, the winner, for Bohemian Rhapsody, and Viggo Mortensen for Green Book. 2018 was a fairly weak year, and the winner of this category was Rami Malek, and it was far and away my least favorite of all these performances. All he does is wear fake teeth and lip sync to Queen. I don't understand why people like this movie or his performance very much. Like, he looks a lot like him. He's okay in the movie. Christian Bale was infinitely better as Dick Cheney in Vice. I think Bradley Cooper should have won for A Star is Born that year. I would say Christian Bale if he hadn't already won an Oscar, but Bradley Cooper, that was the time to give it to Bradley Cooper for Best Actor. It was his, what, fourth nomination for acting at the time. Now he's been nominated for 12 fucking Oscars and hasn't won one yet, including Maestro. So, yeah, Rami Malek, that is a flat-out bad winner. Anything else would have been more interesting. Even Willem Dafoe. I haven't seen At Eternity's Gate, but I know Willem Dafoe is a better actor than Rami Malek, so it can't be worse than this. There, I said it. So we got one in flat-out bad winner. Honestly, it's probably the only one that's going to go in there. Stupid Bohemian Rhapsody. Sucks. 2019, we have Antonio Banderas with his first nomination after a million years in Pain and Glory. Still haven't seen that one, though. DiCaprio for Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. Adam Driver for Marriage Story. Joaquin Phoenix for The Joker. And Jonathan Pryce with his first nomination after decades in the business for The Two Popes. Joaquin Phoenix, yes, one for The Joker. I would say that is at least as good as the best choice possible. And since he didn't win for The Master, I will put it in for career best. I think he's just as good. He's sort of a co-lead with Philip Seymour Hoffman in The Master. He has a tiny bit more screen time just because he starts in the movie a little sooner. But this is like 100% Joaquin Phoenix walking all over everybody. And he's amazing at it. So Joaquin Phoenix finally winning his Oscar was great. After what I think four nominations, if I'm not mistaken. I really need to rewatch Joker. It's been since I saw it in theaters. 2020, the COVID year, as we always refer to it. This is a really good category. Like, seriously, like all five of these are good. Riz Ahmed, Sound of Metal, fantastic performance in a fantastic movie. If he would have won, I would have been happy. Chadwick Boseman, his posthumous nomination for Ma Rainey's Black Bottom. Everyone thought he was going to win. But honestly, other than the fact that it's sad that he died, that was really the only reason people were assuming he was going to win, I think. I don't know. Like, he's great in the movie. He's a good actor. It was sad that he passed away so young. But that doesn't mean his performance is the best in the category. We have Anthony Hopkins, who won for The Father, who I just finally watched, and he's outstanding. And Gary Oldman for Mank. I was like, yeah, I thought Darkest Hour was Gary Oldman's last performance. I forgot he was nominated for Mank, which I probably prefer to either of the other two movies. So Gary Oldman for Mank would have been a better choice. And Steven Yeun, who I haven't seen yet, in Minari. But yeah, everyone thought Chadwick was going to win just because, like, of course he's going to win. He died. That doesn't happen very often. People seem to think, like, every time an actor dies and he's nominated, he wins. That's literally happened, like, two times out of 95 years. And one was Heath Ledger, and the other one was Peter Finch for Network. And they both deserved it, and that's why they won. They didn't win because they died. They won because they gave the best performance in their category. Chadwick Boseman did not do that. He's probably my fourth favorite here, at least tied for third with Gary Oldman if I had to give him, like, some more credit. But Riz Ahmed in Sound of Metal was better, and Anthony Hopkins is ridiculously good in The Father. I'm glad I finally watched that movie. Is it a hit career best? Honestly, considering that him winning for Hannibal Lecter in lead actor is debatably kind of like category fraud because he's not in the movie very much, I would say this is my favorite full-on lead Anthony Hopkins performance. He's outstanding in The Father if you have not seen it. I would have also given Riz Ahmed career best quality because it's the best thing I've ever seen him do, but he's only been in a handful of movies compared to, you know, Anthony Hopkins. Sorry if I'm sounds like I'm crapping on Chadwick Boseman, but I mean, it's just like, That whole show was just a mess with them trying to end on Best Actor, and then Joaquin Phoenix goes up in his sweatshirt and sweatpants and reads off that Anthony Hopkins wins, and then he's not even there. And then they're like, good night. And it was, I didn't mind the show up until that point, but that was like the worst choice ever in Oscars history right there. Why not? Why aren't you ending on Best Picture? Come on. That's so stupid. They learned after that one. That didn't go well. All right. Don't try to manufacture moments that you can't control. All it does is prove that they're not rigged. I guess that's one good thing about it. 2021, we have Javier Bardem for Being the Ricardos, a very meh movie overall, but he's always great. Benedict Cumberbatch for Power of the Dog, Andrew Garfield for Tick, Tick, Boom, Will Smith for King Richard, and Denzel Washington for The Tragedy of Macbeth. Will Smith famously won. We all know what happened. The funniest thing is that not only is this not the best performance in the category, at least to me, but I think a lot of people would agree, it is at best my third favorite. It's a very good biopic lead performance. It's not anywhere near as good as the ones I have in the top row. It's not even as good as the ones I have in the second row, because I don't think it's the best of the year, like I just said. I would have voted for either Andrew Garfield, who just was never going to win because that movie barely got nominated, didn't get into Best Picture like it should have. Power of the Dog, he easily could have won for that, but it's another understated dramatic role, but he's amazing in it. Javier Bardem, he's a past winner. Being the Ricardos is kind of whatever. Denzel Washington in Tragedy of Macbeth, he's very good in it. It's a more interesting role than the ones he's won for, or at least for Training Day, like I was saying earlier. I would rather him win for something unique like this than for Denzel playing Denzel. I would probably say my least favorite one out of all these, as good as he is in the movie, is Will Smith. It's not a bad winner, because he deserves the nomination, but it's definitely not the right choice. That's where I will put him. King Richard was solid, better than I thought it would be overall. But yeah, not only did he not deserve to win, by the time he won, he really shouldn't have won, because holy shit. Who had the second most votes? I want to know. Give the Oscar to that guy. It's probably Benedict or Andrew. And last year, last but not least, definitely not least, fat joke, we have Brendan Fraser winning for The Whale. Like I said, the first person to win Best Actor without their movie being nominated for Best Picture since Jeff Bridges in 2009. Austin Butler for Elvis, who was giving him a run for his money. Colin Farrell for The Banshees of Inisherin. Paul Mescal for Aftersun, which I still need to watch. And Bill Nye for Living, which I also still need to watch. See, the less nominations I get, the less likely I am to watch them, just like an Academy member. Austin Butler almost won for Elvis. Thank God he didn't. He's very good in the movie. He's the thing that's good about the movie. Like, the costumes and everything are good, too. But otherwise, I thought that movie was very messy at best. He's good in the role. He's almost like a supporting role in his own movie, because Tom Hanks is like fucking the lead for some reason, it seems like. Colin Farrell in Banshees of Inisherin. Yeah, I said that right. Was easily my next favorite after Brendan. That would have been a good win if he would have won everything. I would have been like, that's awesome. Colin Farrell's great, especially when he does his dry comedic roles like that. Brendan Fraser is the best kind of like over the top, not over the top in a bad way, but very big performance, no pun intended, that isn't a biopic performance, which is nice. So like the two that were up to win were essentially Austin and Brendan, and they were both in very big showy performances, but Brendan Fraser's was much more realistic, oddly enough. considering he's not playing a real person, there's no doubting, in my opinion, his was the best of the year. He breaks your damn heart in this movie. I don't know how he doesn't. Even if you don't like the movie, goddamn, is he good. He was the best of the year. It is his best performance he's ever had. I'm going to put Brendan Fraser in career best. The McConaissance and the Brendanissance, whatever they called it, both amazing comeback stories. For actors, but especially Brendan's, because he was got shit on for years, basically just for saying that he was abused, blah blah blah. So there we are. Like I said, I'm like, I don't know how many flat out bad winners there are gonna be. It was just the one I expected. Fucking Rami Malek in last place. Worst best actor win of the century by far. Next after that, I would as far as a quality of performance goes, I would honestly put Will Smith over Denzel, but given the circumstances of what happened around his win and the fact that he didn't deserve to win in the first place, I will give Denzel a bump over Will Smith. And Daniel Day-Lewis, while he's not my favorite that year, is an outstanding, transformative, there we go, performance. I will put him there for Lincoln. Gary Oldman, I love Gary Oldman so much, but I might honestly leave him there. He's probably my least favorite of these. Jean Dujardin's, I would say he's next. Leo is great. I'm glad he finally won. I like him in that. I honestly really like Colin Firth in King's Speech. I put him over Jeff Bridges. Sean Penn is probably my favorite in this row. I'll keep him where he is. Leo DiCaprio, physicality wise, because that's not easy, I will give him just over Jeff. But I think I'll leave him there. Yeah, who'd have thought DiCaprio would be in the second one, in the middle of the second row? And on to the career bests, which are, like I said, they're always debatable. No, this isn't the Bible. Who's your favorite career best performance? And if you had a flat out bad winner out of all these, who is it? If it's not Rami Malek, make me laugh by putting someone else in there that isn't Rami Malek. That's your least favorite best actor win of the century. Russell Crowe. I'm going to start over here. He's my least favorite of all these. Sorry, Gladiator fans. I like Jamie Foxx more than Adrian Brody. I probably like Adrian Brody about as much as him. I like Forrest more than I like Philip. Daniel Day, he's going ahead of Jamie. That's a hard nut to crack. Anthony Hopkins is outstanding. Casey Affleck, I like him more than that one. That one, Milk, I like more than that one. Probably that one too. I like him in Milk a lot. More than I think I do. I guess I'm moving him up farther than I expected. Casey, I prefer to Capote. Say he's about there. Matthews, probably good where he is. Joaquin and Joker, I like more than these. I like him more than Philip. I do probably like him more than Philip. Probably like him more than that. I prefer a very realistic, understated performance sometimes over the big showy Joker performance, so I'm going to put him there. Anthony Hopkins, better than these. Better than that. Is he better than Joaquin Phoenix and the Joker? Considering I said Joaquin Phoenix and the Joker's might not even be my favorite of his performances. But they're kind of one-man shows, the both of these. So it's hard to gauge. I think I'm going to leave him there. I've only seen the movie once, so it's like, same with Joker. If I've seen the movie more than once, it's easier to like move him around. The only one I haven't moved is Brendan Fraser. I like him a lot. He impressed me more than most of these impressed me. He's hard to put in there, because like he's a showy, non-biopic performance, so I'd like to put him up higher. But some of these other ones are just amazing, transformative performances. Like Adrian Brody, like he goes through a lot of shit in The Pianist that you kind of forget about until you watch it again. Like, that movie is rough. It's a damn good movie. It almost won Best Picture, for God's sakes, over Chicago. I think I might do that. I'll give the slightly more subtle Casey Affleck bonus points over the bigger, yet amazing Brendan Fraser. I think that's where I'm going to have it. Yeah, there we go. Just to make everybody angry, here is the full screen layout of me saying things from best to worst, slash one of my favorites to my least favorite, by definitely my least favorite. My favorite, probably bar none, is Daniel Day-Lewis for lead actor in There Will Be Blood, Jamie Foxx in Ray, Sean Penn in Milk, Adrian Brody in The Pianist, Casey Affleck in Manchester by the Sea, Brendan Fraser in The Whale, Joaquin Phoenix in Joker, Anthony Hopkins in The Father, Forrest Whitaker in Last King of Scotland, Philip Seymour Hoffman in Capote, Matthew McConaughey in Dallas Buyers Club, Eddie Redmayne in The Theory of Everything, Russell Crowe in Gladiator, Sean Penn again in Mystic River, Colin Firth in The King's Speech, Leo DiCaprio in The Revenant, Jeff Bridges in Crazy Heart, Jean Dujardin in The Artist, Gary Oldman in The Darkest Hour, down to Daniel Day-Lewis again for Lincoln, Denzel Washington in Training Day, Will Smith in King Richard, and all the way at the bottom where he deserves to be, Rami Malek as Freddie Mercury in Bohemian Rhapsody. So that is my ranking as best as I can figure right at this exact moment. You know, ask me an hour from now and I'll probably move something around. But right now, this is it. It's done. I'm not going to do this again, at least for another 20 years. Maybe I'll do other decades here and there. You know, we'll figure that out. I'll probably do Best Supporting Actor next because I think I've seen all of those winners. We'll find out. If I haven't, I'll go watch a movie quick. What category would you like me to do next? Or I could do Best Director. That would be cool. You know, let me know which would be most fun to watch. Since I've already done Best Picture and Best Actor, let me know which one you would like to see. And like I said, tell me who your favorite and least favorites are. You don't have to tell me your whole list, but if you do, that's cool. I'll read it. But at least give me your favorite and least favorite winners of the century. I think that would be fun. So that's it for this one. Once again, my name is Derek, the Convicted Cinephile. Please like, share, and subscribe to the channel down below. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time.
Talk, shop, pop, movies.